My name is Liesl Olson, and I work here at the Newberry Library. And together with my colleagues Karin Christensen and Katie Samples, we put together a really terrific lineup of people tonight to think about the work and the life of Gwendolyn Brooks, and especially her groundbreaking first book of poetry, A Street in Bronzeville, from 1945. Now, I want to give a special thank you to someone who's not here, though may turn up given the rain. Things are moving slowly. And that's Nora Brooks Blakely, Gwendolyn Brooks' daughter, who put together the music we were just listening to. A compilation of Gwendolyn Brooks' favorite songs. Mama's music was written on the CD as she left it here at the library, which is very sweet. And we're going to change our program around a little bit. I'm going to go ahead and start off, and then our young poets will follow me. We're still waiting on a couple of those poets to arrive, so they're going to follow my remarks. I'm going to say a few things about Brooks and her intellectual formation here in Chicago, and especially as it relates to this volume. I thought I would start just by saying a few words about these images that you have been looking at here as it's been up on the slideshow. This is the front and back cover of A Street in Bronzeville it's the dust jacket, right? And this is from the Newberry Collection. So the volume was accepted for publication by Harper and Brothers in New York City at a moment in time when being an American, a good American, meant supporting American troops abroad. This new poet is a patriot, the back cover suggests, our own native daughter. But for African Americans, participation in that war effort was double-edged. How does one fight for democracy abroad without the provision of democracy at home? Brooks called it an off-rhyme situation, and she explores this theme in many, many poems of A Street in Bronzeville, including a really amazing sonnet sequence called Gay Chaps at the Bar. And the bar is both where soldiers go to find a drink, and it's also a bar or a ban, a place where you cannot go. Now, I haven't been able to find a record of what Brooks thought about this war bonds advertisement on the back of the book, which I think is really remarkable. I don't know if she wrote it, or if the publisher wrote it for her. The publisher wrote it. I knew you would know. Right? She didn't like it. Well, there you go. I mean, it's very strange, right? But there you have her her signature at the bottom. Now, the front of the cover, we know she really did like. And she wrote to her editor at Harper and Brothers. She wrote, "The famous Binet." She thought the design was eye-catching, suggestive, and dignified. And then she wrote, "How happy I am that there are no funny figures with patches, open collars, and so on." So presumably what she meant is that there are no stock figures pandering to the stereotypes of her white readers, like William Rose Binet and those of the popular periodical he edited, the Saturday Review of Literature. So as we know, Brooks grew up and lived on the south side of Chicago in a neighborhood referred to as the Black Belt, or better yet, Bronzeville. And she came into her own as a writer through an engagement with people and places that were defined by the demographic shifts of the Great Migration. Hemmed in by the city's racist, restrictive housing covenants, inhabitants of Bronzeville were also emboldened by their community's quest for economic and cultural self-determination. Here was a neighborhood where black people ran key institutions like the newspapers, the bank, and the hospital. A self-contained community that certainly informed the ways that its artists and writers thought about the kind of art they wanted to make and who it was for. Now, this is a really strong theme in a lot of the art and literature that comes out of what scholars call the Chicago Black Renaissance, a kind of tension between feeling restricted or hemmed in or unable to find a freedom, and a kind of joy and exuberance in the intensity and density of life. Consider this large and dazzling painting by Elzear Courtauld called The Room Number 6 from 1948. Here, elongated bodies stretch for space, sharing a mattress, their legs and arms cut out by the frame of the painting itself. A white doll at the baseboard raises its arms as if signaling the cause of their deprivation. And this was done by an artist that Brooks knew very well, Quartor. They worked together at the Southside Community Art Center. She owned some of his work. In Brooks's kitchenette building, which I think we're going to hear tonight, the second poem of a street in Bronzeville, a collective we voices a fear that no dream will survive amid the suffocating stench of onion fumes and yesterday's garbage ripening in the hall. And in the opening scene of Richard Wright's 1940 novel, Native Son, a rat races around the tiny little kitchenette building, trapped and terrified, a horrid little replica of the protagonist, Bigger Thomas. Hungry for space and solitude, residents of Bronzeville sought out privacy in public places, the library, the church, the movie theater, and the street. So consider two different and overlapping spheres of public life in Bronzeville, both of which inform Brooks's imagination. First, the stroll, the name given to State Street between 26th and 39th Streets, which showcased black-owned music clubs, movie theaters, beauty parlors, restaurants, and sporting venues. The stroll spread southward in the 1940s when the energy of Bronzeville centered on the Savoy Ballroom and Regal Theater at 47th and South Parkway, a crossroads captured in a photograph by Chicago-born Wayne Miller. So too did the stroll more largely embody pride and pleasure. Brooks's poem, The Sundays of Satin Legs Smith, also from a street in Bronzeville, inspects the loitering life of a zoot suitor. Brooks writes, "Here is all his sculpture and his art and all his architectural design." Perhaps the stroll expressed the consciousness of Bronzeville as much as the books, poems, and works of art that emerged from the neighborhood. Or to put it another way, life fed into art, in a quotation that is often used, something Brooks said. She said, if you wanted a poem, you only had to look out of a window. There was material always walking or running, fighting or screaming or singing. The bustling spectacle of the stroll was not far from another important site in Bronzeville, the quiet interior of the George Cleveland Hall Branch Library. Leave it to me to bring in a library and librarians, right? At 48th and Michigan Avenue, Hall Branch opened in 1932 and offered relief from the nearby kitchenettes. And I love the exterior photograph on the left, because you can actually see apartment buildings, you know, right behind the actual building. So the head librarian of the Hall Branch is Vivian G. Harsh, and she's right in the center of this photograph at the right. That's opening day. And she cultivated a special collection of books, manuscripts, photographs, pamphlets, and other materials by and about black people. She hired a team of black female professionals who made Hall Branch the center of Bronzeville's book reading community. And from 1933 to 1955, she hosted a book review and lecture forum, which was this incredibly rich venue for writers and artists and intellectuals. So a lot happened at Hall Branch. Here, Richard Wright discovered the works of literature and sociology that comprised his fervent self-education. Poet Margaret Walker found newspaper clippings covering the Robert Nixon murder trial. After Wright had left Chicago, she mailed those clippings to Wright, and he used them as a basis for Native Son. Dramatist Richard Durham did research for his popular weekly radio program that was called Destination Freedom. And Alice Browning flipped through the pages of Esquire and Story magazines to understand how she might launch a similar periodical called Negro Story, aimed at reaching a wide black audience. Langston Hughes, who spent long periods of time in Chicago, worked on material for his theater troupe called Skyloft Players, which put on plays at sociologist Horace Caton's Parkway Community House. And I don't know if this is true, but I've been told that in 1950, when Brooks won the Pulitzer Prize, they actually called her at Hall Branch. And that's where she got the news. So one final place worth mentioning is the Southside Community Arts Center, where Brooks took an I'll say something about this side really quickly too. This is Richard Wright coming back to Chicago to actually donate material to librarian Vivian Harsh and help build up an incredibly rich collection, which is of course still there and which you can work in. So the final place I'll mention is the Southside Community Arts Center, where Brooks took an influential poetry workshop on Wednesday evenings with many of her peers. It was taught by Inez Stark, a woman who worked at Poetry Magazine, wrote art reviews for the Tribune, and also directed exhibits for the Renaissance Society. She's the one with the hat and the netting. Here, Brooks wrote and revised many of the poems that would comprise a street in Bronzeville, including the great long poem, A Ballad, The Ballad of Pearl May Lee, which Langston Hughes dropped by one evening to hear. Now, when Brooks sent off her manuscript of A Street in Bronzeville to Harper and Brothers, what she didn't know is that it was immediately passed off to Richard Wright for review to read. And he had left Chicago at this point, and in fact, they hadn't yet met. He was about a decade earlier, and they wouldn't meet until later that year through Brooks's editor. But the manuscript to him was a kind of startling dispatch from the neighborhood that was also his real, really important to him, a neighborhood that had in many ways defined him as well. This is what he wrote in his review of her poems. The poems are hard and real, right out of the central core of Black Belt Negro life in urban areas. She takes hold of reality as it is and renders it faithfully. There is not so much an exhibiting of Negro life to whites in these poems as there is an honest human reaction to the pain that lurks so colorfully in the Black Belt. Only one who has actually lived and suffered in a kitchenette could render the feeling of lonely frustration as well as she does, of how dreams are drowned out by the noises, smells, and the frantic desire to grab one's chance to get a bath when the bathroom's empty. Miss Brooks is real, and so are her poems. Now, Wright did, in fact, object to a few of the poems in the volume, and including a poem called The Mother, which is a poem about abortion. But thankfully, Brooks did not heed his advice, and she kept it in. It's the, fourth poem in that volume. But he did threw his full weight behind Brooks, and he wrote to Harper's, America Needs a Voice Like Hers, which is, of course, the title of our program tonight. So Harper and Brothers published this volume in August 1945, the very same month that World War II ended. And she wrote to her editor, Brooks wrote to her editor, how nice it was for peace and me to appear together. Now, there's, of course, a lot more to say about Brooks after A Street in Bronzeville and the course that her career took, and I think especially her radicalization in the late 60s. She's a poet who worked in so many different modes, but I've always felt that A Street in Bronzeville forecasts a great deal of what was to come, especially Brooks's commitment to her community. So I'm gonna end there and hand things over to our young poets, who come from Gwendolyn Brooks High School, right? And also a poetry group called Rebirth Poetry Ensemble, which you'll see in your programs, is a group that is really one of our best groups in Chicago, devoted to really social justice and the performance of poetry. So it's a real pleasure to have you all here tonight, and I'm gonna give you the front of the room. Thank you.
With the advertisement of imitation. never successful because the high tone is laughing too. But all the raw dark of the music, the real,
the right,
the natural respect of self and steel.
Sisters, your hair is celebration in the world.
When you step off a plane at the airport in Las Vegas, Nevada, the first thing you see is slouch. Your final descent into Vegas Earth is a step into my grandmother's addiction, where she has watched Lucky Seven spin backwards until every direction is up, until every pull of a lever feels like a captain concealing its wheels below a 737 with sounds blaring every which way, so much noise until it all becomes just one. Her machine's chair, she never has to buckle a seatbelt. She is free to move about the cabin. She is free here. I wonder if my grandmother has ever looked at me the way she looks at Slouch. Wonder if I was ever enough heaven in a moment for her, if I was ever the sweet sensation of coins rattling in a bin of winnings, if I was ever the smoked cigarette and a cup of porters before I knew my grandmother's condition. I assumed grandparents were distant, difficult to reach, that every grandson to grandmother relationship consisted of questions about basketball or music 2 years too late. I assumed every grandson chased their grandmother's attention like she chases her jackpots. I spend my flights to Vegas trying to figure out how I can shape myself into the machine, how I can paint myself with the golden metallic glimmer of the sun that beats down on its desert city, how I can learn to accept gold tokens as if they are love. I study the art of the airport slot machines inviting nature, because every time I look at my grandmother, she seems like she's looking at the last time she remembered who I was. It is impossible to make me treasure. I do not and will never know where I have to stand to step in front of the machine. All I know is that family interventions have no power and 12-step programs rarely lead to progress. So I have learned to muffle the sound of the word gambling when it swirls around conversations with my grandma. Las Vegas is her heaven when everyone around her sees hell. And it is what I am most jealous of. Even when casinos have turned more family gatherings into interventions than not, and addiction has taught me pessimism, even when gambling has taught me a reality I was never ready for, I still want to be the jack.
How's everybody doing tonight?
My name's Ona. I'm with the Reverse Poetry Ensemble. I write poems.
I'm gonna do a poem for you guys. The title of this poem.
Give me 1 second to get this mic straight.
The title of this poem is Taking a Quiz on White Supremacists During African American Lit. True or false, ain't no picnic without a hanging body. True or false, white women have black boy disappearing magic. True or false, blacks died picking cotton. Now blacks die in it. At Independence Day barbecues, do they A, pass around racism like we do Big Mama's pound cake? B, talk about how great America was between sips of Henny, or C, eat Harold's chicken and call it good old slave food? What makes Burger King a white supremacist favorite fast food? A, a double Whopper with a disappearing tape. B, a 10-piece chicken nugget with the Charleston Massacre. In this section, you will use a unique fact to answer a question. Ronald Reagan's favorite snack was jelly beans. True or false? Did he make sure Crack Rock looked like his favorite coconut jelly beans? Bill Clinton loves black women. True or false? Did he call their sons super predators in between bites of under-seasoned chicken? Rick Snyder sat at a table with George Bush, recommended tips to ecological terrorism. True or false? White men who use water in their oppression love seafood. Essay question. Do white supremacists eat CPS school lunches? Yes, that's the scariest thing. White supremacists aren't just rich white men like Rick Snyder who gamble with our lives. They don't just eat caviar in restaurants in Trump Tower. They don't just listen to Carrie Underwood and eat deer in redneck trailer parks. They scream to all my Southside niggas that know me best at homecoming and ask to copy my math homework the next day and sit next to me in English class and offer to share Skittles after saying Michael Brown asked for a bullet. And you don't know until Trump conversations regurgitate or on election day where they parade Trump t-shirts through school and wear USA shorts and post videos of them saying nigger proudly explain how they voted for Donald Trump and listen to Chance the Rapper. White supremacists eat hot flamin's with cheese and scream love salsa. During African American lit, he grabs my locks and says, Onam, when I look at you, I don't see color.
People, and as poet laureate of Illinois and as poetry consultant to the Library of Congress, she was constantly sponsoring poetry contests all over the state, all over the country, and often funding those contests out of her own pocket. Koresh, if I read your reflections on your recent volume and revised the psalm, I'm remembering, I think it was your story, somebody's story in that volume that you edited, about Gwendolyn Brooks turning up for a reading and really asking, who am I reading with? Where are the young poets that I'm reading with, right? She didn't like to read by herself. She always wanted to read with other young poets. All right, next on our lineup is Koresh Ali Lansana, a poet and teacher who is currently on faculty in the creative writing program at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. He has published 8 books of poetry, and he's served as editor for many more. He knew Gwendolyn Brooks as a friend and as a mentor, which has made him an especially brilliant editor of this recent volume that just came out called Revise the Psalm, Works Celebrating the Writings of Gwendolyn Brooks. And it's a volume that's full of poetry by many different poets, many different kinds of poets, but also reflections on Brooks. And it will be for sale in the lobby at the conclusion of this event, as will Camille's books, too, and some other books by Brooks. So without further ado, give it over to you.
Thank you, young ladies. Be careful. Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Yeah, I'm gonna have to work with the mic because my son blew the mic up and then twisted it, and then, because that's what sons do.
Try that.
Thank you. And speaking of the Youth Poet Laureate Awards that she did bankroll for 30 of the 32 years she was poet laureate, statewide contest, K-12, And this was pre-email, right? This was so Nora knows this well because you were part of the mimeographing and the post and the snail mail, something we don't even know where post offices are anymore, right? And on paper for those ceremonies, there were supposed to be 10 winners in K-8 and 10 winners in high school, but there were always 40 plus young people, right? And she gave them all gifts. Walkman, I know young people don't know what a Walkman is any longer. Bicycles, books, and checks. Sometimes books, every now and again. You don't remember, but I remember bicycles one time. I remember one, at least once. And I'm happy to announce that with Illinois Humanities, they dropped council. So with Illinois Humanities and support from Chicago Community Trust, we are reinvigorating the Gwendolyn Brooks Youth Poetry Award. And we will actually, in a whirlwind kind of way, have our first set of winners ready to present at the reenactment of the unveiling of the Picasso in August. So we're moving very quickly, but after that, the awards will be reinstituted in perpetuity. So we're very grateful to the Illinois Humanities and Chicago Community Trust for that. And some of you will be hearing from us soon about judging lots of poems from all over the state. Liesl mentioned a moment ago about the Pulitzer, a little bit of the Pulitzer story, and I know we're talking about a street in Bronzeville, so we're not to Annie Allen, but one of my favorite stories, sort of following up on that, is that when Miss Brooks did receive that news, Henry was 5, right? Yeah, 9. He was 9. And I thought you told me he was 5. Yeah. Okay, so he was 9. And the electricity was out in the house. And so the next day, miraculously, when the media came to the house, the electricity was on. Someone in the community that she loved, the community that she embraced in all of her work from her first book to her last, went out and found a way to get the electricity on in that house. And I think of that story often because that's who she was and that's how the community loved her back. And that is who and what we need to be for one another always, but certainly right now. Liesl also mentioned the story regarding the mother and Richard Wright and her editor, Elizabeth Lawrence, both asking Miss Brooks to pull the poem. And I want you to think about this for a moment because I think this is also very significant. This was 1944. Okay, the book was published in 1945. It's a poem in the voice of a woman, persona poem, in the voice of a woman who's experienced multiple abortions. Miss Brooks said the poem stays or I pull the project. For 1944, 45, right? It's a remarkable story. And from her first book, From a Street in Bronzeville to her last, and particularly, I think, in A Street in Bronzeville, what part of the work that she establishes, I think, in a groundbreaking way, is that she provides voice, creates real, human, authentic, genuine experiences for women, and Black women in particular. And just for an example, some of my favorite of her poems, but certainly in this book, is the Hattie Scott series. And I'm just gonna read a couple of them. So this is Hattie Scott, The End of the Day. Now, mind you, again, this is 1944, 45, giving voice to a Black domestic worker. Eons before the Help, right? Eons. Hattie Scott, The End of the Day. It's usually from the insides of the door that I takes my peek at the sun, pulling off his clothes and calling it a day because I'm getting the dishes done about that time. Not that I couldn't sneak out on the back porch a bit, but the sun and me is the same. Could be. Cap the job, then to hell with it. No lolling around the old workplace. but off, spite of something to see. Yes, off until time when the sun comes back, then it's wearily back for me. And then at the hairdresser's, again, proof that that some of the language that, you know, language sort of is always recycled, I think, like fashion. Like, our young people are dressing like 80s and 90s now. Like, we didn't live through that once, but they're going through it now, right, somehow. At the hairdresser's, give me an up, sweet Minnie, with humpteen baby curls. About time I got some glamour, I'll show them girls. They think they so fly, a-strutting with they wool a-blowing round. Wait till they see my upsweep, that'll jump them back on the ground. Got Madam C.J. Walker's first, got poor old grower next. Ain't none of them work with me, men, but I ain't vexed. Long hair's out of style anyhow, ain't it? Now it's tied up high with curls, so give me an upsweep, Minnie, I'll show them girls. You heard actually a poem from one of my sons, Onam, and my oldest son, Niall, who was somewhere stuck in traffic on his way here. And Miss Brooks, when Miss Brooks actually approved of my wife, it's a funny story. My wife, Emily Lonsana, is an actor, trained actor and storyteller. And she had performed in a theatrical production of Miss Brooks' work at Columbia College well before I met her. And she performed to the diaspora. And Miss Brooks particularly loved that she chose that poem and that she performed that poem. And so in 1993, I received a call from Michael War, the founding ED of the Guild Literary Complex, to help Miss Brooks conceive of this idea that is now 20 some odd years strong, called the Gwendolyn Brooks Open Mic Awards, where, again, another example for generosity, we're awarding a poet who was selected by the audience a $500 personal check. So that first time that we did that, I mean, there were probably 125 poets read. We were there for hours, and she sat through the whole thing, right? And she wrote a check. And so once we helped her conceive of the award, the contest, then I was, because I live on the South Side, picked her up. Of course, if I wanted to pick her up, to give her a ride to Wicker Park. And so I go in, Emily is with me, I go in to retrieve her from the apartment building in South Shore, and then I help her out. And Emily steps out of the car, and then this huge smile comes over Miss Brooks's face. And so as I'm helping, and they hug. And as I help Miss Brooks into the back seat, she just looks at me and nods and says, I approve. That was it. She's on. And then she didn't request, she sort of demanded that she be the first person called upon the births of my two oldest sons. And I had to oblige her. I had to call my mom first. So Miss Brooks was the second for both, but I didn't tell her that she was the second. And she made fun of me when we brought Niall, our oldest, out in the world to a dinner. We used to have dinners every Christmas and every summer. I brought Niall out of the house that first time so she could meet this boy she wanted to see in the world. And she said, you're carrying him like a football. I said, ma'am, I'm from Oklahoma. I can't really help myself. A street in Bronzeville received, let me back up and say, Annie Allen, her second book, for which she received the Pulitzer, received $100 less in advance money as a street in Bronzeville. A part of it, of course, that folks were concerned that Annie Allen was too hard, too difficult, that the language was too esoteric and adventurous. And also, an unspoken truth there was that it was very overtly less black than a street in Bronzeville. And Annie Allen was sent to many folks to vet, many poets. Richard Wright looked at it again as well. And they came back and said, okay, sort of 50-50, but we'll publish it. And then gave her less money. And of course, it won the Pulitzer Prize. And one of the interesting things in that story regarding a street in Bronzeville in context that is referenced in the Pulitzer jury report letter, which I won't read, but if you have a chance to take a look at it, it is now up on the Pulitzer website. It's pretty scandalous. But one of the quotes from the Pulitzer jury report that I think is very interesting from Howard Canby is that some years ago, Gwendolyn Brooks, a Negro writer of unusual ability, published A Street in Bronzeville, which made a great impression on all its readers and had what is unusual for poetry today, a wide sale. Just think about that, right? The letter really digresses from there. I won't go into it because we're not talking about Annie Allen. But you should read this letter. What else can I tell you? I can tell you about Bronzeville, which Liesl showed you a map, and the import of Bronzeville, I think, to Miss Brooks cannot be understated, to that community, to all of the Black Chicago and the South Side, but Bronzeville in particular, I think because of the concentration, because it was the Black Belt, it's because where we lived and could live, that it was at the same time the heart of culture on the South Side, and in many ways, the heart of culture in the city. Jazz, blues, I live in Bronzeville now. I live two blocks from the house in which Miss Brooks grew up on Champlain. I live on Forestville, which is the street where she went to elementary school. And right around the corner from where we live is one of Louis Armstrong's homes. So think about how rich that culture and the community which she looked out of a window to find her poems. Where was I going? I fell in love with Miss Brooks's work. I'm originally from Oklahoma, as I referenced earlier. And I fell in love with her work in eighth grade while falling in love with Beowulf and this new form of poetry called rap. It's amazing to think about how those three things, or those three elements, right, they're all very much interconnected. I had no way, of course, of knowing in small town Oklahoma in 1979 that I would grow up and move to Chicago and meet her and then be mentored by her. And which was a pretty remarkable thing to experience. And I was fortunate enough to be one of 11 students in the last college level workshop she taught before she passed. And so I'll just close with a little bit about her in workshop. Ms. Brooks was an amazing teacher, a meticulous, mischievous instigator of mind riots, is how I phrase it. She would, one of the things that I'm very envious of Anna at Champaign-Urbana, right, is her lesson plans, right? Her lesson plans were about stacked this high on pieces of paper with a web of rubber, cut different colored rubber bands holding them together. She would actually bring these lesson plans, these things, these clippings. Sometimes they were often newspaper clippings of things she read. She read everything. And gave us the charge, of course, to respond to current events, right? Which is something that Avery and I and my wife work with these young poets that you heard from, to respond to what's happening, to pay attention to what's happening now, and be a part of that conversation. So she would bring this stack of lesson plans, you know, unwrap the rubber bands, peel through clippings, whatever it was she wanted to mess with us for that evening. And she'd sort of put it out there on the table like a piece of meat and then just sit back and just do this and rub her hands and watch us, watch the light bulbs go off. And of course, as you can well imagine, Miss Brooks, as I put it, you know, believed in precision and exactness with her work. So she was a very, very fierce editor. I still have a folder of poems dripping from the red ink from 1996, still dripping. A very, very, very fierce editor. an amazing, and her love for and her passion for young people, I just think, and her generosity and her kindness. I wouldn't have ended up at grad school if it had it not been for Miss Brooks. And you mentioned earlier, my good friend Major Jackson, who will be here in a couple of days, has a great story of he drove her, I think, from Philly to New York, perhaps, for a reading. And she said, well, of course you're going to read with me, right? You know, Major was like, okay, you know. But that she was always reaching out to mentor to young people. And I'm a product of that. I'm a very happy product of that. And I will close with one poem, but before I do that, this is a galley for a book you'll all want to get very soon. This is A Surprise Queenhood in the New Black Sun, The Life and Legacy of Gwendolyn Brooks. This is the biography that Miss Angela Jackson has written. That'll be out in May, in a few months, May, June. And it's remarkable. It's a remarkable book. Liesl mentioned revised the psalm. I also just completed the edits on today, in fact, on an anthology of essays, of critical essays on Miss Brooks that will also be out this summer via Haymarket. And that book is called The Whiskey of Our Discontent, Gwendolyn Brooks as Conscience and Change Agent. And that will be out this summer as well. Do you have your hand up? Yeah. Oh, okay.
I've only been living in Chicago a couple of years, but I went down to 63rd Street to where Miss Brooks used to live, hoping to find her old apartment building, and just an afterthought.
63rd and where, sir? I think you were a few blocks off, maybe. Go ahead. Well, it depends on in which era. I mean, the house on Champlain was at 43rd and Champlain. And then there was a home at 74th and Evans. There was, yeah. Go ahead. Right. that's a big question, my friend. That's a big question. We can talk about it maybe later, but that's a big question.
I'm just curious if it was burned after Martin Luther King was
killed. That had been further west.
Okay.
Yeah, that had been further west.
I'll catch up with you.
Sure. Okay. All right, and I'll close. Well, thank you for the question. I'll close with this. Patent leather. That cool chick down on Calumet has got herself a brand new cat with pretty patent leather hair, and he is man enough for her. Us other guys don't think he's such a much. His voice is shrill. His muscle is pitiful. That cool chick down on Calumet, though, says he's really it. And strokes the patent leather hair that makes him man enough for her. Thank you. Oh, I brought this. You talking about this? Huh? You mean leave it? I'll leave it. But I want it back.
Thank you. Thank you. That was fantastic. Such a much. It's good. Tim Samuelson, you're up next. He's our city's cultural historian and works out of the Cultural Center. If you've ever visited him in his office, it's its own archive filled with treasures from all over Chicago. When I went to visit him just yesterday, I noticed Lincoln logs from Frank Lloyd Wright's son are in his office, and he's also brought some of his artifacts today. Is that sounding a little funny? Yeah. I won't say too many more words because I want to make sure we have enough time for both you and Camille. Tim.
I'll hold the microphone. That sounds good. Now, can I do things with both hands at the same time? We'll see. All right. Well, anyway, There have been so many theses written and people speculating on how an author creates their work and what their inspirations are. And you could go on endlessly about it and give your theories about it. And as you could even see in that manuscript where somebody was having their thesis looked at, you can be really off the mark. But in terms of Gwendolyn Brooks, and I think about when I read her work and where does it come from, she's very much a product of Chicago. Forget about that little bit in Topeka. She was hardly there at all, as you know. But educated in the Chicago public schools and of the streets of Chicago. But it was interesting that in her background, in growing up in her part of Bronzeville, it was an interesting neighborhood of beautiful old houses from the 19th century and in a background with good schools that she went through in Chicago public schools, including the famous Englewood High School, which has a distinguished alumni to it. And you can think about her education and what might have influenced her. Now, of course, went to school in one of the earliest of the Chicago junior colleges. I give you the Woodrow Wilson Junior College of Chicago, later renamed Kennedy King. It still exists today. And the college was in this old former high school building on the side. The domed building on the side is the old Normal Teachers College. So certainly this is something that would have played a role in the education of Gwendolyn Brooks. A very academic-looking building with the dome and the classical columns, indicative of a place of higher education. But I would say that if I was going to attribute a defining part of Gwendolyn Brooks's early education, even though wonderful things probably came out of Woodrow Wilson here, a large part of the origins of what I see in Gwendolyn Brooks's work is right here. It's a building you might never take a second look at, a big, imposing, hulking, gray brick building built in 1892 at the corner of 34th and State Street, right in the middle of the old Stroll, the old entertainment district. It was a place that was built originally as an apartment building, temporarily used as a hotel during the World's Columbian Exposition, run in a strict, in a transitioning neighborhood, whites-only policy until 1912, when African-American residents were invited to go to live in the building. It had the exotic name, the Mecca. This is the building where Gwendolyn Brooks, leaving Woodrow Wilson School, it's the depths of the Depression. Jobs are hard to find. The state of Illinois Employment Office makes a recommendation of an available job for her to apply to. Jobs are hard to come by. There's money that is needed in the family. This is the Depression. The Bronzeville has taken a heavy hit in the Depression. The address, 3308 South State Street. And this is the doorway that would have walked through applying for this new job. The sign over the entrance, the Mecca, through an arched opening over the building. Once you walked in that entrance, you might not have had a good impression about where you were about to potentially go to work. This is the inside of it. It probably doesn't look much different from the time that she was there. John Bartlow Martin was a writer who would describe the interior and what it was like walking into the Mecca for the first time through a door like this with just the light bulbs hanging from the ceiling, plasters cracked, the tiles coming off the floor. Inside, a powerful odor assaults the visitor at once. Musty, heavy, a smell compounded of urine and stale cooking and of age. Not necessarily an unpleasant odor, but a close, powerful one, which, like the smell of marijuana, is never forgotten. Now, going into this dark environment, you would walk through a corridor quite a ways in darkness. And then there would be an amazing transformation into what was probably one of the most incredible interiors in the city of Chicago, because you suddenly went from darkness into light. A giant atrium, two giant atriums in this building, with light pouring through the skylights. The apartments entered off of iron railings. It kind of gives you an idea of a street in New Orleans turned inside out. The place that she went for her job interview was one of the upper floors. It was an apartment that was partially a home and partially converted to an office, and so would have climbed up the stairs. And here's a part of it right here. So I'm just going to hold it for a little bit because it's a... But... And, it's here if you want to see it. Oh, here.
Okay, there you go. I got it, though.
There you have it. Anyway, a piece of the Mecca. This is the piece of the Mecca as well. That's good. You can put it down. Thank you very much. So, let's see, here we go. The place was often described as a place with this great skylight, but it was so dirty and cracked that it was described as the light coming down in ethereal diagonal rays into the space, as you can see in this picture. Finally, reaching the place that Gwendolyn Brooks is going to have her new office, and I introduce you to the Reverend Dr. Eustace Nathaniel French, spiritual advisor and bishop. And he was the head also of a church on the storefront, the Zion Holy Spiritual Mission Laboratories. This is one of his advertisements as it appeared in the Chicago Defender. Do you know how to get what you want? Many people believe in spiritual help in business, work, games, love, marriage, domestic affairs, etc. If you believe you may be of benefit also in your undertakings, we are here to help you. Send $1 for our spiritual advice. Okay. Now, yeah, $1. All of your answers needed. Unsuccessful in love, you can write in your letter. Also, what you could also get was if you played the policy and the numbers, they would send you specially, spiritually, the numbers. Now, he is a man who came from Jamaica originally. At the age of 15, he settled in New Orleans initially. And there he partook of the culture of magic and spiritualism and voodoo. He comes to Chicago and he starts out with a tradition of chemistry. He lists himself as a chemistry and a manufacturer of toiletries, but later taking it in to making things such as love potions and things to help you in life, in love, in magic, and built up in his apartment in the Mecca secretaries who would help answer the letters and those who would answer the pleas of the people writing for spiritual guidance. Now, one thing that is interesting, if you read about this, the way it's written, in fact, it's kind of hard to read. It doesn't quite track the way it should. This is a picture of him right here, and Gwendolyn Brooks did recall him. I believe she called him a fierce-looking man wearing a black hat and running this organization. Stop your worrying. Now, part of the job was probably answering these letters because her background is in writing. But he also manufactured product, love potions, thunderbolts, love balls. And part of the job was to deliver these to many of the clientele were people who lived in the Mecca. So the job, in part, entailed walking the long corridors in the great skylit atrium of the Mecca to deliver the goods who were ordered from the people who ordered them. This is the part which I think is something that's influential in the idea of Gwendolyn Brooks and what I see, because it is the whole principle of, and how wonderful to be in a place where they have things made out of wood. You would knock on the door. The nature of the Mecca flat was very unusual in terms of the people who lived there. Many of the people who moved there in 1912 were some of the old guard of Chicago's Bronzeville, who had positions as chefs and positions of authority in business and owned businesses. They occupied what were originally the original four-bedroom apartments, occupied them in their entirety. It was a symbol of achievement and success to have a fine apartment in the Mecca flat. The building was huge. The turnover from white to black was within 2 years. And the landlords, not able to rent the big apartments, started to cut them into smaller and smaller units. And so you had a total mix of people of different economic circumstances, backgrounds, geographic origins, and where they came from, living in the Mecca. So in knocking on the door to deliver your goods, you would encounter suddenly, face to face, people from many different places, mind frames, economic backgrounds, all with their own story to tell. When I read things like The Street in Bronzeville and other works, I get the idea of introduction of diverse people, almost as if you had knocked on the door and the door opened. So personally, I think this is a major part of the education. This is actually people who lived in the Mecca that you see right here. Now, one thing that is interesting that I often wonder about is that the Reverend French wrote articles, little advertisements that were only tiny little advertisements that were in the Defender. They were not very long. And they were not written that well. In fact, you could see from the one that we projected, it was something that was kind of hard to read how it was tracking. A month and a half after Gwendolyn Brooks went to work in French's office, what appears but a full-length article in the Chicago Defender? Now, it was possible in the Defender that you could write your own advertisement and it would be published in the form of a news story. All of a sudden, you have coming out of French's office a very well-written piece describing the functions of what is offered. Very different from what you saw in those early advertisements. Did Gwendolyn Brooks have anything to do with this? I don't know. But it is interesting that this only one of these ever showed up in the Defender. It showed up a month and a half after she arrived. And after she left, there never was one again. So there we have it. Now, it was not a great place to work. Gwendolyn Brooks remembered this as absolutely one of the worst experiences that she ever had in her life. Working in this office, selling these potions, delivering them from door to door, it was a humiliation. But you needed money. She sent money for her family, and it helped out quite a bit. Jobs were hard to come by in the Depression. So she put up with the misery of it. But Reverend French saw this was somebody who was gifted and somebody who could talk well. He had a church and a storefront on the ground floor of the Mecca. He thought that Gwendolyn Brooks was a perfect person to be able to stand up, talk, and participate in the church. Told her that she had to show up on Sunday, and this would be part of her job. She didn't want to do it, and he said that if she didn't show up, she would fire. Don't show up on Monday, you won't have a job anymore. She wasn't going to do it. That was the last straw. She didn't show up. Comes back, she didn't have a job. And thus launches Gwendolyn and frees her from this terrible place that she found so miserable. Now, if you look at the books that are written, Street in Bronzeville, and Maud Martha and others, is say, I see this kind of spirit of introducing people with an element as if you had been knocking on the door. So it's the old kind of knocking on the wood. Here are people, all with different personalities, being introduced to you instantly as you read. There also was the poem, which was made into an anthology book, based on the Mecca itself in 1968. And one of the, and that involves somebody who went from door to door in the Mecca looking for a lost child. Have you seen my child? From door to door. The door opens. Different reactions, including the door opens. It's a man described as the prophet. He opens the door to the request to look, have you seen my child, with a big yawn. And it goes through the whole thing about this man. And he was somebody who sold magic thunderbolts. And that was somebody who had love balls. There was the revenge after all these years, in a way, for a job that was very much hated. And what happened? So happened to the Mecca Flats? Well, the Mecca Flats kind of went along for a number of years. It got worse and worse in condition. And then finally, in 1951-52, it disappears. And again, the influence of Gwendolyn Brooks, the people of the Mecca. But then here it goes, and the wrecking ball pounds into it, and that's the end. 34th and State, you go there now. Actually, if the Mecca had survived, it was one of the most remarkable buildings in Chicago with the skylit atrium and the ornamental iron. In fact, in historic preservation today, nobody would let that building go, but people don't often appreciate things in their own time. And it was in terrible shape, and it was considered to be something that was a disgrace and a slum and should be torn down, and in that spirit it was taken down. In its place is one of the masterpieces of modern architecture, Crown Hall at the Illinois Institute of Technology campus. It's even appeared on a postage stamp and is celebrated as one of the masterworks of the great German architect Mies van der Rohe. It's a building that is all about iron, steel, and glass and light. But there still is something when looking at this building in terms of its materials and how you relate to it. It has its ancestry in the Mecca Flat, and you could even say that the Mecca Flat has never gone away at all. At least when I visit Crown Hall, you feel the spirit of the Mecca will always live on. And I think even Gwendolyn Brooks made an allusion to this self. The beginning of the poem, In the Mecca, published in 1968. Sit where the light corrupts your face, Mies van der Rohe retires from grace, and the fair fables fall. Thank you.
Those are some of my favorite lines from Brooks's poetry. Thank you, Tim, and I invite all of you to come up and, lift up the Mecca railing, if you'd like, at the end. Our last presenter is Camille Dungy, who is perhaps the hardest person to introduce because she's a dear, dear friend of mine and a fantastic poet. We were undergraduates together at Stanford, and it's been amazing to see all the amazing depths and turns her poetry has taken since I knew her when she was pre-med. And her latest book of poems is called Trophic Cascade, which she explained to me is a metaphor for motherhood. It's also one of the title poems in her volume. It's a terrific volume. It will also be for sale out in the lobby. I'll let her go from here. Okay. Camille.
Hello, Chicago. I am really quite honored to be here talking about Gwendolyn Brooks. In Chicago with Miss Nora Brooks Beckley here and Koresh and Liesl and all these wonderful people. When Liesl said that she was planning on doing this and could I please come, I said no. I'm supposed to be in like four different cities this week and this is insane. And then she gave me those eyes and said, Gwendolyn Brooks. And you know, instantly, it was a yes. Within about 30 seconds. I was invited to talk about the ways that Gwendolyn Brooks informed me as a writer, which is something of an impossible task. Because I think some part of my very DNA as a poet was forged in the understanding of a world that Gwendolyn Brooks created. My mother graduated from Inglewood High School. My grandparents owned a home a little bit further south, about 77th, around Jeffrey. My grandmother was a school librarian. And I brought with me my Kindle and a really new version of the selected poems. And I feel like I need to establish the fact that this is because my collection of A Street in Bronzeville does not leave my house. and my other original issued version of the selected poems is nearly falling apart and is signed by Miss Gwendolyn Brooks with a "Keep writing, Camille." Doesn't leave my house. So then I have this version that I bought sometime later. I thought I would just read a poem by Gwendolyn Brooks and bring her into the room here. "When You Have Forgotten Sunday, the Love Story. And when you have forgotten the bright bedclothes on a Wednesday and Saturday, and most especially when you have forgotten Sunday, when you have forgotten Sunday halves in bed, or me sitting on the front room radiator in the limping afternoon, looking off down the long street to nowhere, hugged by my plain old wrapper of no expectation and nothing I have to do, and I'm happy. Why? And if Monday never had to come. When you have forgotten that, I say, and how you swore if somebody beeped the bell, and how my heart played hopscotch if the telephone rang, and how we finally went in to Sunday dinner, that is to say, went across the front room floor to the ink-spotted table on the southwest corner to Sunday dinner, which was always chicken and noodles, or chicken and rice, and salad, and rye bread, and tea, and chocolate chip cookies. I say, when you have forgotten that, when you have forgotten my little presentiment that the war would be over before they got to you, and how we finally undressed and whipped out the light and flowed into bed and lay loose-limbed for a moment in the weekend bright bedclothes, then gently folded into each other. When you have, I say, forgotten all that, then you may tell. Then I may believe you have forgotten me well." Right. Miss Brooks said, "I am interested in telling my particular truth as I have seen it." And that seems to me to be one of the most important things about what her work is doing. The Street in Bronzeville is this looking out of the window and seeing the lives and describing them with dignity and honor and care and no holds barred and no sort of secrets kept. There's a degree of honesty and certainty and grace and faith in the humans that she had around her that is so important and I think revolutionary for this Black woman to be able to write her truth in such incredibly beautiful language, careful language, insightful language, right? And that to me is part of the great glory of her existence in the world. Also, though, this way in which she tells a kind of survival narrative that's so important. I used the last few lines of Annie Allen as the epigraph for my third book of poems, "Let Us Combine." There is no magic or elves or timely godmothers to guide us. We are lost, must wizard our own way through the screaming weed, right? Let's wither our own path out of the screaming weed. So like this sense of We let us combine. I love that. That part seems so important, right? Let us come together, but we have to make our own magic. We can't count on anybody else. This is our magic for the making. So important. My daughter was due late June. Not late June, early June. And I would say to the little belly every day, June 8, June 8. And she very wisely, I'm sorry, this is what happens. Like you become a mother and you flip the information. I would say to the belly, June 7th, June 7th. And she very wisely said, no, I will come the day after Miss Brooks' birthday. I am not going to share the birthday of this person who you consider such a hero. Lisa asked me to read some poetry of my own, and I will read the opening poem from this book, Trophic Cascade, partly because of the ways in which I'm thinking about what Gwendolyn Brooks taught me about looking, about attending and caring, and the ways in which we do and do not have license always to value, or the equipment always to value all that's around us, but the necessity of the poet to at some point stop and pay attention and cherish that which is there. Natural history. The rufous hummingbird builds her nest of moss and spider webs and lichen. I held one once, smaller than my palm, but sturdy. I would have told Mrs. Jeffers from Court Street if in those days of constant flights between California and Virginia, I'd wandered into that Oakland Museum. Any chance I could, I'd leave my rented house in Lynchburg. I hated the feeling of stuckness that old city's humidity implied. You need to stop running away so much, Mrs. Jeffers would say, when my visits were over, and I learned down to hug her. Why her words come to me, the woman dead for the better part of this new century, while I think of that nest of web and lichen, I cannot rightly say. She had once known my mother's parents. The whole lot of them, even then, in their 20s, must have been already as old as God. They were black. The kind name for them in those days would have been Negroes. And the daily elections called for between their safety and their sanity must have torn even the strongest of them down. Mr. Jeffers had been a laborer, the sort I regret I don't remember. He sat on their front porch all day near his oxygen tank, waving occasionally to passing Buicks and Fords, praising the black walnut that shaded their yard. She would leave the porch sometimes to prepare their meals. I still have her yeast roll recipe, the best I've ever tried. Mostly, though, the same Virginia breeze that encouraged Thomas Jefferson's tomatoes passed warmly through their porch eaves while we listened to the swing chains, and no one talked or moved too much at all. Little had changed in that house since 1952. I guess it's no surprise they come to mind when I think of that cup of spider webs and moss made softer by the feathers of some long-gone bird. She used to say, I like it, right here, where I am, in my little house, here, with him. I thought her small-minded. In the winter, I didn't visit very often. Their house was closed up and overheated. Everything smelled of chemical mothballs. She had plastic wrappers on the sofas and chairs. Everyone must have once held someone as old and small and precious as this. Thanks. I I could say that as a poet, Miss Gwendolyn Brooks taught me a lot about form, how to write a good sonnet, like a sneaky sonnet, right? Like one that like you don't necessarily know until afterwards. You're like, what? How did she do that? How to write a really solid protest poem also, right? How to write a poem of attention, as I said. But most importantly, Gwendolyn Brooks taught me how to write a love poem, right? She taught me how to love a people, a self, a family, a wild person, a place. I'm gonna close with one last poem from a street in Bronzeville. Vacant lot. The vacant lot. Mrs. Coley's 3-flat brick isn't here anymore. All done with seeing her fat little form burst out of the basement door, and with seeing her African son-in-law, rightful heir to the throne, with his great, white, strong, cold squares of teeth and his little eyes of stone. And with seeing the squat, fat daughter letting in the men.
Come on now.
When majesty has gone for the day and letting them out again. Thanks so much. Thank you.